It's my pleasure to be able to welcome you here tonight. I want to start with just a few announcements about existential analysis, and then I want to introduce our speaker of the evening. But before we do that, I was wanting to inquire, who here, for whom is this the first time that they're hearing Alfried Laengle speak here? Yeah. Very good. Well, welcome especially to you first-timers who are here, and welcome to those also who have been here many times. It's good to have you here. The next intro seminar will be taking place on November 5th. It's a two-day introductory workshop led by some of the people who've gone through the training in existential analysis. And so that will be happening here in Vancouver on November 5th there. There's also some books that are available for you if you're interested. And one of them is really hot off the press. Just this summer came out a book called Living Your Own Life, Existential Analysis in Action. Okay, thank you. There. Well, it's my pleasure then to welcome Alfried here. It's also very wonderful to have his wife, Dr. Sylvia Laengle, here. Wonderful to have you here from Vienna. So for those of you who don't know Dr. Laengle, let me just say a few words about him. Dr. Laengle trained as a physician and as a psychologist in a variety of different countries, but then ended up practicing and has practiced for really his whole professional career in Vienna, both medicine initially and then psychotherapy more lately. He worked very closely for about 10 years together with Viktor Frankl there, and we're in very close contact during that time. And then during that time, he and a few others began and founded the society that became the society that we have come from now, the International Society for Logotherapy and Existential Analysis. And so this became a training body and is really now worldwide the largest existential psychotherapy training body that exists there. Dr. Laengle functions as the president of this international society to this day. For those of you who are interested in him, if you Google his name, you will see a wonderful website, and you will notice that he's a prolific writer with many different books, many different articles, many of which are free for you. So if you go to laengle.info, you will find a lot of information that will be helpful for you. It's wonderful to have you here. Again, Alfried, he comes just 2 days he arrived on Tuesday evening, yesterday had a full day of training, today has a full day of training, and now is here tonight. And you will marvel at his energy, even at a time like this there. So it's good to have you here with us. The topic for our talk tonight is going to be on aggression, which is different than some of the other talks that we have, and an intriguing one, and we're looking forward to hearing and learning from you. Thank you, Alfried.
Thank you, Derek. Thank you very much, Derek, for your introduction and presentation and for arranging all this here, the evening, to make it possible that we can gather again and speak about a topic which is very ubiquitous. Is there anybody here who has no experience with aggression, passively or actively? Please give a sign with your hand. So what I'm going to talk about is something we all know and we encounter in many, many, many experiences in our life from childhood on. Even babies can be aggressive in their crying and convey information that they are in a real danger or feel subjectively to be in a danger and become aggressive. And mothers and sometimes even fathers get set up with these babies and crying babies. And it has a lot to do with the environment and with the interaction with the environment. So everywhere we encounter aggression and we have to deal with it in this terroristic period of time which we go through, and the aggression becomes a big question. Where does it come from? Why is there so much aggression? And how can we deal with it? And how can we understand it? And not only in the social life, but or in the public life, but it is also a theme in the private life, in relationships. There happen so easily little aggressions or heavy aggressions. Aggressions can destroy relationships, and aggressions can hurt and produce pain and reject and make life very difficult. But on the other side, we need aggression. Life is not possible without aggression. So how to understand this, how to bring it together, this is what I would like to talk about tonight. I would like to start with a picture of our life, our normal life, how we can come to a good life, and to then to go over to the blockade of a good, fulfilling life, and how we react, and this, and then position the aggression in this area, and to give a glimpse on neurological background of aggression, and the actual knowledge about where aggression comes from and how it is related to the brain and to the hormones, and to place it also a little bit in the social interaction by psychological investigation, and then to describe different forms of aggression, and finally to describe how to deal actively with aggression, what we can do, how we can detoxify aggression. Well, every human being has a tendency towards a happy life. We all want to live happily and fulfilling and having experiencing values and have a good time. And in existential analysis, we found that there is a main, a central topic which leads to a fulfilling life. This main topic is dependent on oneself. It's the environment alone cannot make us happy. No human being can be happy without himself, herself. It needs our presence, our agreement to be happy. Many people are happier than they think. They do not realize it. You may ask yourself, actually, am I happy? What is lacking for my happiness? What do I need? Maybe I am happier than I think. Because some suffering belongs to life, and suffering doesn't necessarily destroy a full inner fulfillment, which is the deepest form of happiness. Inner fulfillment can be there when I'm grieving, when I'm sad. Inner fulfillment, this deep form of happiness, depends on something which is me. It depends on my active agreement, on my giving inner consent to what I do. So if I live without inner consent, I'm losing myself. Inner consent means I can say yes to my actual life, to what I do, to how I behave. This agreement to myself, this concordance with myself, is absolutely necessary for coming to a fulfillment in life. Without me, there is no happiness. There is no fulfillment. This agreement, this inner yes to, for instance, sitting here, do I feel an inner yes? This is what I want to do now. This is what is possible for me. This is what is allowed, what is correct, what is right, what is important, what is valuable, what is possible to me, and what is feels like being meaningful. There is a promise. We will hear something about aggression. And I can use this knowledge professionally, personally. Or I'm just interested in the structure of human being and of existence. And therefore, it's interesting for me to hear something about aggression. Then it is meaningful. So this inner yes depends on many issues. But it is like bundling the different tendencies, the different dimensions, the different areas of interest. And I get a feeling, a condensation of all these knowledges which are confluent and give a raise and bring ashore this inner yes. Yes, it's okay, it's good. This is what I want. Then I am in agreement with myself. And I'm sitting here, and I'm here with myself, in tune with the situation, in tune with the scene. It's so important that we live in tune with otherness, with other things, with the world around us, with other people, and of course, always in tune with myself. If I'm not agreeing with myself, then I'm alien. I'm foreign to myself. And how can I experience fulfillment when I'm a stranger to myself? It is so important that we bring together, that we harmonize ourselves with our life situation. And we can work on it. We can do something. We can try to deal with the reality. This is a first dimension, to accept what is there. We can come in tune with the values and look at what we can like and what is valuable for us. And we can, this is a second dimension, and we can look at what is important for us, what is interesting for me, what is really corresponding to my own and to my essence, and what is allowed to be done, what is ethical. This is a third dimension. And to be in tune with the wider context, the bigger context in which we are, that something fruitful will arise. This is the meaning dimension of existence. So this inner yes is a composition of four dimensions, of four basic dimensions, the four dimensions of existence, the dimension of the world and the reality, the dimension of life and relationship and values and feelings, and the dimension, the third dimension, is the dimension of being myself, to really be myself, to be in concordance or in congruent with myself. And the fourth dimension is to be in line with the development, that something valuable may show up in the future, that I can contribute to something valuable in the future. So four dimensions: world, life, myself, context in which I am, development, future. Context in time is future. I'm always living for a future. We are sitting here for our future. These dimensions are dimensions of existence because we cannot escape them. We have to deal with them. We are in a world, if we like it or not. Maybe we can emigrate to Canada. Many people did it and do it. Some remain in Europe still. But so we have to live in a world. Wherever we are in a world and have to deal with the necessities of this world. We have to eat and to work and to earn money and to look for overcoming in this actual world of physical world, chemical world, biological world, economic world, social world. And this is a great demand in our life, to be able to be there where I am, in the midst of this reality, where I can change something, but not everything. And I cannot escape the world. As long as I'm living, I have to deal with facts, with realities, with conditions, which allow me something, which gives space, offer possibilities, but which also limit myself. I have to follow the laws, the physical laws, the chemistry laws. If I don't follow these laws, I will not survive. So this one inescapable dimension, the world, is the first dimension. I am there, and the fundamental question is, can I really be there where I am, in this working place, in this family, in this relationship? Is there enough space and protection and support to be really there? The other dimension, which I have to deal with and cannot escape, is that I'm a living entity. I'm a living body. I am a living human being. This means that I'm born and I grow and mature and will die. I'm subject of time and of continuous change, not only on the physical level, but also at the psychological level. There is a flow. Life is flowing. And we sometimes have the feeling that time is flowing. We cannot hold it. It is like water which we have hold in the hand, and after a minute it is all gone. It flows away. This aspect of flowing, of flow, of movement, of change, is permeating the life dimension. I'm living. This also means that I experience my being there. I'm not like a stone. I have senses. I feel. I have emotions, affects. And with this capacity, I can discover what is valuable for me, what touches me, what moves me. Again, the inner movement. We perceive values by being touched, by looking at what is moving me. So the second dimension is the fact that I have to deal with the reality, or with the reality that I am alive. And I have to care for my life, physical life, psychological life. And life means, oh, I live, I experience, I feel, I'm in relation. The third dimension I have to deal with is, I'm always me. I'm never somebody else. For the whole life, for my whole existence, I must be me. Only the psychotic person has a chance to exchange it for a while. He has it, but this is a great suffering at the same time. If I have the feeling that it's not me who thinks, but it's you who think in me, that's a terrible feeling. But 99% of the human being constantly experience it's me. I have to come along with myself. I have to live with myself. I cannot be divorced from myself. I must care for or be aware of, how do I decide? Do I live responsibly? Can I stand behind what I do? Because if I cannot stand behind that, I'm losing myself. Then I have the feeling it's not me who did it. I'm sorry. It went through me. It passed by. I reacted. It was not what I really wanted to say or to do. I get the feeling of being alien, of being outside of myself. We have to be ourselves. And this, there is the question, the basic question, is it allowed to do what I do? Can I look into the mirror if I behave that way? Can I see myself in that what I do? Is my action reflecting me? Is it corresponding to me? Can I let me see in the way I behave? And this is a fundamentally ethic dimension, which allows encounter with others, which allows that person to person can come together. World, life, me, and all this happens in a greater context. I'm not happy. I cannot be experience fulfillment when I see, if I don't see that something valuable comes into this world, happens through me, that I am the author of something valuable, that I am productive, that I can contribute to something which grows, becomes important, that I can contribute to the thrive of a child, for instance, of a project or of an idea, of some work. I want to experience myself as fruitful, as instrumental for something. This is the meaning dimension of existence. I see myself, I put myself into a wider context. And in this wider context, I see myself connected with others, otherness, other people, other things, and see myself productive and experiencing also valuable contexts in which I am. So this allows me to live with inner consent. Inner consent is bundling all these four dimensions. When I have a yes to world, life, myself, and the context in which I find myself, then I can live with a great yes. Then in this situation, it is okay, and I am really present. I am fully present. And can say yes. Give my consent, my approval. Approval to what I do and to how I do it. If this is blocked, if I am blocked in one or more of these dimensions, if I live without inner consent, if I feel forced, if I feel coerced, if I feel rejected, if I feel devaluated, I cannot find a yes. And then suffering starts. And when this suffering is so strong that I cannot really deal with the situation, when it is overwhelming me, then we have an ancient animal system of reaction. Coping reactions which help us to overcome the situation, not by resolving the causes of this suffering, but just by escaping, just by surviving. So when we are blocked in the flow of life, where I can be present personally, decidedly, responsibly, actively, controlling my situation, when this is blocked or not possible, and when we cannot resolve the difficulty in the very moment, then we switch over to an ancient system, psychodynamic reactions. They are not personal. They are coming out from the history of our evolution. We find these coping reactions in animals in the same similar way as in human beings. And this much older knowledge, which came out from millions of years, whereas the personal activity comes out from some hundred thousand of years. But this old knowledge to survive is taking over dominance in our behavior. Coping reactions. Coping reactions look for the stabilization of the vital situation. They establish or fix the psychic state. They collect information in the feeling and produce moods. The psychodynamic produces a mood, like a feeling of a constant feeling of anxiousness, of insecurity, or of depression. These are moods which come up from the collected information of my actual life. Of course, there are sometimes moods which are produced by biochemistry primarily, by genetic elements, etc. But many moods, and mostly moods, are products of psychological experiences, of collected information. When we are unhappy for a longer time, we become sooner or later depressive. The mood reflects my being in the world and is located in this psychic dimension, in this old animalistic information processing. And it mobilizes for the protection of the human being, for the protection of life. It mobilizes drives, alertness, and also coping reactions. The function of this old system, of this psychodynamic system, the function is to preserve life. No other function. The old system doesn't look if my behavior is correct or incorrect, or if I can stand behind it or not. This was not the theme for the animals. Just surviving, just reducing pain. This is the meaning, the purpose, the goal of this old psychodynamic system, which is in us. Me as a person, as the individual who I am directed towards dialogue, towards judgment. This is the world of the human being. But the other world is the world of impulses, no dialogue. The psychodynamic is egoistic in itself. There are four levels of coping reaction. Within this psychodynamic, within this old system, to which belong the moods, the drives, the personality traits, belong also the coping reaction, which we are focusing now, because aggression is one of the coping reactions, one type of coping reactions. Coping reactions are reactions to situations. Something is happening to me and is stimulating a counter reaction to preserve life. And there are different levels of coping reactions. Coping reaction, the basic coping reaction is in all these four dimensions of existence, we can find them. The basic coping reaction is the economically easiest reaction. This is the fundamental movement of reducing the loss, preventing a for a continuation of the damage. For instance, when I have difficulty to be there, to be in, to go to an exam, for instance, and I cannot resolve the situation because I didn't learn enough, then anxiety comes up. I fear the exam, and if the coping reaction starts dominating me because me as a person cannot resolve the situation, I'm already too anxious, I will avoid to go there. This is the easiest way not to be exposed to a dangerous situation. If it is clever or not is another question, but for coping reaction, this is not interesting. Coping reaction just want immediate relief of pain or of difficulties, which is seen from a point of view of evolution, obviously helpful to overcome. It may produce damages to one's career, to other people, but for the moment, I overcame. So the fundamental movement is always a reduction of the possible damage. If this is not enough, or if I cannot do it because I'm already in the cage, then starts a paradoxical movement, starts a trial to fight against. We become hyperactive. We do more than we should do. This is like a person who is going to be drawn in a lake, starts to hyperactivity in the hope to grasp some wood, some boat to overcome. This hyperactivity has its meaning seen from a point of view of evolution. But sometimes it destroys more than it is helpful. But in general, it helps more. And so hyperactivity means out of the fear for the exam, I'm learning and learning. I already know it, but I still feel insecure. I'm learning 120%, 150%. I'm overlearning, hyperactive, because I have to go to the exam, and I must bring away this insecurity. And so I do too much, which is in general not very helpful, but sometimes people are calmed enough that they can compete with the situation. If this is not enough, then the person, the individual, comes into a high danger. And out of the high danger experience starts aggression. Aggression is the highest form of activation of the human being. And in this activation, we combine all our energy and bring the situation to explosion and have the highest chance to survive. We will speak about aggression a bit more later. And if this is not enough, animals do what human beings do. They start with a freezing reflex. Halfway overwhelmed, halfway passivated already, we wait, don't breathe, don't move, hope that the situation passes by and that the enemy doesn't see me. The freezing reflex. So in a group of people, there can come up a freezing reflex to some people. So when the teacher is asking, who will tell me something about the history of Napoleon? Freezing reflex in the classroom. So nobody moves and hopes that I'm invisible. Now we understand the location of aggression in the human behavior, in the human being. The aggression is an automatic protective reaction of a high intensity, implying a lot of energy. using so much energy, because this gives a momentum which is needed, because the lower levels or the easier levels, the lighter levels of coping reaction didn't work. Neurobiology did a lot of investigation, and in the last 10 years, there were very interesting findings about aggression. There were experiments where people have been asked to become aggressive and to behave aggressively without being triggered by somebody, just out of the blue, to act aggressively upon others. And it showed up that this kind of arbitrary aggression, playful aggression, does not activate the motivation system in the mesencephalon and does not produce hormones of well-being like dopamine, opioids, oxytocin. The characteristic of drives have been investigated many times. A drive is an action which produces, which stimulates the motivation, the motivation system, and produces well-being hormones, these positive hormones. And this is the reason why when we fulfill a drive, when we satisfy a drive, then we get good feelings. When we are hungry and we are eating, we get a good feeling. Drives are necessary for the animals and for the human being to survive. And nature installed them in a way that they are combined with a feedback loop in which we get positive feedback by well-being hormones. And this is stimulating again our motivation system. So when we have a drive, we are inclined and prone to follow this drive because it produces pleasure. But this pleasure has not been found neurochemically in the brain when people act aggressively out of themselves, just because they were asked or animated by a stupid scientist who said, can you act aggressively against somebody? The Milgram experience was in this area, but there were many mistakes. There's a big misunderstanding. In the Milgram experience, people acted aggressively because they trusted into the experimenter. And there was a part in that Milgram experience which is not known very much. It is in the original description, but it is mostly forgotten to cite it. When the person was accompanied by two scientists in riot, who told, the one of them told them, act aggressively upon your victim. And the other said, but only if you want, you don't have to produce pain in the object, in your victim. Then people didn't do it. So it is not so that the human being is motivated or so easily being seduced to act aggressively upon other people. They do it when they believe that it has a meaning, because a scientist tells them, do it. And they say, well, he must know. So he wants to investigate something, so I do it. It's out of human trust that the Milgram experience brought up this result. So this means that deliberate aggression does not have the characteristics of a drive.
Sorry,
does not have the characteristics of a drive. We have no aggression drive. This is something very important because during 100 years in psychology, you could read that aggression is a drive in the human being, that human beings must be aggressive because it belongs to their nature. But looking at the characteristics of a drive, activating of the motivation system in the mesencephalon and producing well-being hormones and pleasure, it's not there. So we must, from this we can conclude that aggression is not a drive. This is somehow a revolution in psychology. And if we look at the motivation system, we can find that we have all symptoms of a drive when the motivation system is directed towards actions of cooperation, of fairness, of trust. And when we can do something so that we can belong to a group. So this very old motivation system has a very cooperative intention or direction or inclination. So from this we can deduce when aggression is not a drive, it is a reaction. And reaction means that something happens before aggression comes. There must be a stimulus. There is no aggression without stimulus. So aggression is like an answer to something. But what is the stimulus? The stimulus, most generally speaking, is social rejection. When people experience being rejected by others, this stimulates aggression. This stimulates aggression because it goes over the ACC, the anterior cingulate cortex, and it can be shown in neuroimaging that the ACC is stimulated and have the same imprints like when people experience physical pain. It is in the same place located. When you pinch a person with a needle fMRI, you can see the ACC is stimulated. And if you have a social rejection, the same places are stimulated. So social rejection is neurologically perceived like physical pain. Disrespect is neurobiologically similar to physical pain. This was Naomi Eisenberger and Werger and Singer in 2004 were these first publications. It's only 12 years that we know it. And it has been found that massive injustice triggers another element, which is very interesting for existential analysts. It triggers the disgust center simultaneously when it is massive. Because disgust is the experience that a border has been violated. Something which does not belong into my stomach because it's poisonous or bad for my body produces disgust. So when there is injustice, my border is violated. The strongest stimuli for aggression are, taking all these investigations together, the not belonging to a group or the rejection by others. So So if people are outcasts, they react aggressively. If people are not taken into the group of football, they become more aggressive than the other players, and they react aggressively against other pupils or comrades. These were investigations which came up in 2006, 7, and 9 by Leary, Birkeland, Richman, etc. And it has been found that this makes sick. Being excluded, being rejected, not being connected with a group makes sick, especially when it cannot be communicated. Communication is very helpful to reduce aggression. But when communication is not possible, when they cannot talk with other people about their experience, when they are lonely, when they are left alone, when they are put on themselves, then the aggressive neurons and the anxiety center are loaded and remain loaded. And the blood pressure arises. There is an interesting parallel, which is important for the physicians, a parallel between the pain of social rejection and the sensitivity for physical pain. People with a high sensitive for physical sensitivity for physical pain, which are very need little to feel pain. They suffer. In the hospital, we have many of them. They have a high sensitivity of social rejection, and vice versa. People who are very sensitive for not being loved, for not being admitted or integrated, when they fear that, when they are very sensitive, when they are vulnerable in it, they have also a higher level of pain, physical pain sensitivity. Another finding was that out of the relation with others, which is also important for the hospital, for instance, the production of pain relief hormones is elevated. When people have the possibility to experience relationship, they experience less pain just by being related to other people. So we see always that this area of physical pain and this social area, they are located at the same place in ACC and influence each other, vice versa. The attachment style also influences the feeling of being rejected. People with ambivalent or avoidant attachment style who have difficulties to maintain a stable relationship or avoid the relationship, these people have quicker feelings of being rejected, of despise or contempt. So we are a unity, psyche and body, physical pain and social pain goes over the same way, over the same processual way to our experience. And this happens also in babies. Babies also react sensitively to the outer circumstances. When they do not feel to be to live in a cozy atmosphere and to be accepted and to be warmed, they react quickly, aggressively. And young children learn to react aggressively when this behavior is the most effective behavior to get some attention. And so crying babies come up out of this exchange with the environment, with the relation on the relational level. There is also, there have been investigations about the on the psychological level. In the 90s of the last century, there have been an investigation of 37 school shootings in the United States. It was published, this was published in 2002, this investigation. And there have been discovered typical characteristics. Two-thirds of the school shooters have been extremely depressive or in despair before their action. They have an unstable psychological state. And even more, 76% of them had suicidal thoughts. So they are at the border to survive psychologically. And almost all, 98%, and this is very interesting, experienced immediately before they acted a significant loss or a significant defeat. Rejection. Pain. Psychological pain. 81% felt hurt. 71% felt rejected or bullied. So it is not because of pleasure that people are aggressive. It is because of protecting themselves. When they are in a critical life, critical situation. The same is true with the homicide rate. It has been found that the homicide rate differs 80 times over the globe, according to different social characteristics. 80 times more or less homicide rate in the world. And the systematic investigation, this was done in 1993 by Park and Xie, combined it with mainly two social economic issues. One is the level of economic state, which is there is a correlation. And one is the difference of economic states within a country. If you have a high difference between rich and poor, then you have much more homicides in a country. But the high difference of economic states is not influencing the property theft. It's interesting. Only the social economic state of the person is correlated with the property theft. But the homicide, the real aggressive act, the killing of others, is combined with the big tension between the rich and the poor. How is this? Can this be explained? The pain theory can be used. Joachim Bauer, this is a theory of Joachim Bauer, who also worked on this. The experiencing of being poor is humiliating the people in front of the rich. And they feel pain and injustice. And so out of this, they become aggressive. It is quite a lot to see that in countries with a big difference between rich and poor, you have 80 times more homicides than in countries where the difference is very low. So we see that aggression is a coping reaction. It is a reaction to stimuli of rejection, of devaluation. And out of this knowledge, we can describe different forms of aggression. In existential analysis, we have a very differentiated understanding of aggression. I didn't find such a differentiated understanding of aggression in other psychologists. The closest is in psychoanalysis, in the modern psychoanalysis, you have quite similar understanding of aggression. Our understanding derives from the dimensions of existence, which I was delineating before. My relation to the world, to the to life, to myself, and to the greater context. If I am inhibited in my relation to the world, then I experience the danger of not being able to be. I am in danger to survive physically, emotionally. I have the feeling I cannot be, and if I cannot resolve the situation, I start reacting, and if it is very dangerous, I become aggressive. I cannot support it anymore. And this type of aggression has to do with the being. Because when I have the feeling, when I get the information from the situation that my being is in danger and I cannot support it anymore, the crying of the children, for instance, in the little apartment, it's not bearable anymore, then I react on the same level. I react on the level of being. And the level of being put into the aggression, into this already high level of activation and irritation, brings up hate. Hate is a form of aggression which has the only aim to destroy the enemy, to destroy the stimulus. And I get the feeling that I want to eliminate this people, this person, these children. I could send them to the moon. I could kill my mother-in-law when she comes into the kitchen and looks into all these pictures and gives some salt into the soup without asking, and again and again. It takes me away the place to live, and I could kill her. And this is hate. This means the question is to be or not to be. This is the question in hate. Either you or me. And since I cannot escape anymore, I cannot avoid, I cannot fight, I cannot be hyperactive anymore, I already spoke with her several times and it's not helpful, then aggression comes up to protect my own being in front of her, or in front of the children, or in front of a boss, or whatever the situation is. If your being does not permit my being, then I must destroy it. This is the only way out. This will to survive is apparently deeply anchored in us human beings. And it is especially coming out of the feeling of the sense of powerlessness, which is activated in this case and leads to the desire to run down the threat. I could strangle my mother, for instance. Of course, we don't do it, or most often we don't do it, but we feel that impulse, we feel this aggression. And it is very human, and it is good to understand with which dimension it has to do. When I cannot be, I want to hurt somebody physically or psychologically. If it does not turn into hate. It becomes anxiety. So the aggression protects me for falling into an abyss of anxiety. And it allows me to overcome, to remain on the level of being. This is the existential theme of this form of aggression. So the aggression in the first dimension of existence, the aggression in the dealing with the world and with the conditions, this aggression is destructive aggression. The other dimension of existence leads to another form of aggression. The dimension of existence of I live, I have a life, I want to live in a relationship, because in the relationship I experience that my life, I experience good feelings. A loving relationship is something so valuable. If this is in danger, then a typical aggression comes up. The form of aggression has to do with life, and it is rage, fury, wrath.
Can you explain
the
word
"rage"
again? That differentiates the first form of aggression, or the second form from the first form?
I'm coming to the explanation of the second form of aggression. The first form of aggression is hate, destruction. Remember this strangling, yeah? Or mother, yeah, mother-in-law effect, yeah. Okay. But when I deal with my life and I'm inhibited to come to a real life or to live my relationship and to have good feelings, when life is lacking, when my life is too cold and I cannot compete it with a reaction of the lower levels, like stepping back or hyperactivity, then the aggression comes up, and this aggression is furious. Furious means that it is full of life. I'm investing myself in order to live. It's a strength to protect love and relationship. The furious says, I want to live. If I allow this to happen, then I cannot live, so I must stop it, and I must shake you that you stop your behavior, because your behavior produces an effect that I cannot love you anymore, that I lose the good relationship to you. If you continue that way, I'm enraged, and I shake you, and I say, are you blind? Don't you see what you do with me? It's not destructive. It's awakening. It is moving, it is shaking. It is full of life, of this movement which is typical for life. In my rage, I feel my life surging. It makes me hot. Rage, in the rage, I have a red head. In hate, I have a pale head. Pale lips, small eyes. I'm looking to when I can shoot. This is hate. Hate is very dangerous. It is silent. It shoots out of the background. Whereas rage, fury, is lively, moving, loud, is shaking. Rage is inner search of life. It happens often in relationships. Also in good relationships, when one partner in a relationship gets the feeling that my life and my good life and my relationship and the value which I see in our relationship is in danger, and it could not be resolved by talking. You didn't hear, you didn't understand, you didn't listen, you were not there, you repeat the same thing. And then it is important to mark my area by saying, this is enough. Rage against one's father, who was treating his daughter insensitively. But she still loves him and suffered from the suppressed life and wants to shake her father in order to feel him and make him more and have more relationship with him. One does not want to suffer anymore. Rage searches for relationship, for closeness, for life. And if it does not become rage, a development of resignation can start. The existential theme is rage protects our liking to be, the value of life, the value of relationship. In the third dimension, when we deal with ourselves and look for an encounter with other people, when we feel that we are lost, that our self-value is lowered, then an aggression comes up which is intolerant and affrontive, defiant. There is grudge, anger, annoyance. This is a different form of aggression. And we want to understand, what is the theme in this aggression? What are we fighting for when we feel grudge or when we are defiant? When there is anger, and this may lead to hurt, punishment, revenge. This is the aggressive level of the in the dimension where we have to deal with ourselves. I want to be me. And to be able to live what is important for me. And if this is not possible, if I'm forced by others, if I am not seen, if I am stepped over, I have to move myself. And if all other activities, decided activities and automatic behavior, reactive behavior, protective behavior, the first two steps were not sufficient, then this aggression comes up. The aim of this aggression in this third dimension is not overcoming the situation like hate in hate or preserving the relationship. The aim is I want to be seen by you in order to avoid being further wounded. Please look at me, we say, this aggression is saying, if we take it phenomenologically. Look at me, I am here and you are hurting me. Could you please stop? Not because the relationship is going to be in danger. No, because I, myself, my borders, what is important for me with what I'm identifying myself. I cannot be any longer myself. And this aggression contains normally reproach and is typically blaming. The type of this aggression is outrageous, the nerve. How could he do that? I'm not going to tolerate this. I can't let this happen to me because it is a deeply felt injustice, because it is degrading and does not allow me to be as a person. I'm not going to be treated this way. I'm going to show you. The dynamic tends towards the outer. The dynamic becomes inconsiderate. This is unbelievable. And you see from my gestures, and when you empathize to this aggression, that this aggression aims to install borders, boundaries, and shifts the attention to the person. It is loud, it throws objects. Anger wants to be seen. And when the impulse is combined with the feeling of justice, then it becomes punishing. An injustice must be punished. This seemingly reconciles when I can punish the one who is stepping over me, not considering me and my thoughts and my ideas. It wants it is vengeful, and it wants to harm the offender, to offset the injustice, so that he will learn his lesson. It wants to establish justice and equilibrium. It is accusing. It can also be turned towards oneself, then it is self-accusing. It is like a para-ethical reaction, has the appearance as if it were ethical, has the beginnings of ethics, inasmuch as it establishes justice when I'm punishing, when I'm vengeful. But it is not real ethic. It has just some similarity. It has some tendency towards it. The trigger for this reaction, of this aggression, of defiance, grudge, anger, annoyance, is a constantly being unrecognized, overlooked, ignored, treated unfairly, or not taken seriously, which makes me inconsolable, desperate, produces tension, because I'm overlooked. Situations in which one has the feeling that this may not be as it is, lead to the feeling, I'm not going to take it. Pejorative terms are used, like this cow, this silly cow. Devaluation, because I feel devaluated. We move on the same level. On the level, what happens to me, we give it back. The motivation is to assert oneself. And the aim is to draw boundaries in the relation to others, the re-establishment of boundaries, to maintain boundaries, so that the others, or I myself, cannot stop over me unopposed. Therefore, it is an intolerant, affrontive movement. The existential theme is to be able to be oneself. I want to be myself. I want to be respected, to be valued. And if this does not happen, it is so wounding and painful, like physical pain. In the fourth dimension of existence, we are dealing with the content, the context, the bigger context, the context in social environment and the context in time. We want to have a good future, and we want to be fruitful in the family, a context of many of us, in the working place, another context of us. And if this is disturbed, and if I cannot resolve the situation, I become aggressive, and it is the type of playful aggression, cynicism, sarcasm. Playful aggression means that people, seemingly out of nothing, behave aggressively. They take a nail and walk along the parked cars and scratch a dozen of cars. just by fun. This type of aggression was one reason why people thought that there is must be an aggressive drive, a drive that pushes us to be aggressive sometimes. But it is the seeing the meaninglessness of their life, the emptiness, and to overcome this hurting emptiness, they start to destroy contexts. Why should other people have a nice car when my life is so scratched? This is not just. So they start to damage, to destroy things. Vandalism. Vandalism within youth is widespread in Europe, maybe also in America. Daubing walls, torturing helpless victims. There may be mixed, they may be mixed with elements of other needs, including narcissism, fear, or tests of courage, etc. Or the production of confusion and chaos, to enjoy the destruction of values, living out of meaninglessness in others. I will show them how meaningless it is in this world. And therefore, it is a pleasure to produce chaos in school, in a class, or in a working place. Mobbing, bullying is another form of creating aggression of this kind. The readiness to engage in mobbing is increased in companies where the meaningfulness of work is a problem. Public institutions. You have much more bullying in public institutions or in schools where the learning is not conveyed in a way that the pupils can understand it, can understand the meaning of it. Then bullying becomes an issue. Behind this aggression, this playful aggression, is the feeling of meaninglessness. And this is very painful. We cannot support a meaningful existence. And so we try to overcome it. And these aggressions are cries, outcries of, can't you see how meaningless my life is? And they need help from others because they can't resolve the situation by themselves. Playful aggression. Outrage is also a form, an outcry which reaches out into the public, into the system. It is an aggressive impulse. This cannot be allowed to continue. The situation is perceived as outrageous, and for example, work assignments are considered an imposition. And also, in this form of aggression, you often have a mixture of resentment, anger, hatred. A teacher, for instance, who finds that the student's ongoing pranking during his lesson is outrageous. Cynicism. What is cynicism? Cynicism means the opposite of what is said. As a result, we have a devaluation and the creation of an ostensibly different context into which the situation is placed, in the knowledge that it isn't right. For instance, when we say, the dearest mother returns to wear you down, telling you that the room you live in which you recently painted yourself isn't yours. The dearest mother. We mean the opposite. But we say, and this is cynic. Or, I'm completing this important, meaningless, important statistics for our wise boss so that they can be hung up on the toilet wall. Cynic. Sarcasm is an enhanced kind of aggression hidden behind apparent humor. humor which is already cutting into flesh. Sarx in Greek is flesh. It is a biting derision. For instance, my boss, he is the biggest wimp in the world. Or after presenting the invoice to a person who is known to be a gambler, the person who presents the invoice is asking, are you paying with chips today? It is hurting. It is really very cutting. Or a stranger approaches a one-armed woman. She had an amputation of the left arm. In the street, telling her, I'd like you to smack me, but with your left hand. There's something where we start smiling and at the same moment our smile is frozen. It is too much. This is transgressing a border. We cannot step in and give way to that little bit of humor which is so sarcastic. The aim of this aggression is to install some meaning. This man may have made this joke with this woman to get rid of the tension, because being one-armed is difficult to fit into his worldview. He has difficulties to, how can life be meaningful if you are only one-armed? It's difficult to come to a fulfilling life. And so people start to be aggressive of this in such a way. So these different forms of aggression are combined with protecting oneself, one's theme of existence, of these four basic themes, of these four basic dimensions of existence. They are so important for ourselves that we cannot survive without dealing with these dimensions. And so we must protect ourselves. Let me define now aggression. What do we understand with aggression? Aggression is a violent treatment of an object. Aggression is violation. Violent treatment, there is power, there is might. The power, what is power? Power is assertiveness, an agency that enables a purposeful effect. Power is something good. We need power. When we are powerless, we feel paralyzed. We need power that we are able to do something. So it is structuring power. Power is necessary for processes in all areas. Body, physical power is necessary to be able to walk, to do something. Health gives us power. We have power of the psyche and the power of coping reactions. We have power of the mind, the power of the will. We have power in the society, the power of the state. So power is structuring our life and is enabling us to do something positive. It can be used to do something negative, of course. So power in itself is very important. But what is violence? Violence is a power, is also a power, but a power that tries to overcome a resistance. Solely with its sheer force, without consideration of the value and meaning of the resistance. The self-interest is rated as more important than the third-party interest. Violence is always egoistic. I do it only for me. We all use violence. For instance, if the door is not opening, we are breaking the bolt of a lock with force. This is violence, but this is a responsible violence. But we use also physical power to get with what we want, and if we do it against resistance, then we abuse or we rape. Or to use other means of power, for instance, the professional relationship. One's authority as a psychotherapist is a power abuse. Aggression is violence, is egoistic. And therefore, we don't like people who are aggressive, and we don't like people for their aggression. Aggression is inconsiderate. Aggression can damage. Aggression is always tended towards an object, because it is stimulated. It is object-related. There is no blind aggression. If we don't see the trigger of the aggression, this simply means that the object is hidden or forgotten, so that we don't see it, but it must be there. Where there is smoke, there is fire. But aggression at the same time has something positive. It is a protection for surviving. Life is not possible without aggression. There are too many situations in which we would not overcome if we could not be aggressive. And it can also be positive for the receiver of the aggression, for instance, in a relationship. This fury is experienced as being negative at the beginning, but through this shattering and shaking, it can lead to a positive result that I really understand, wow, this must be really important for you when you are so furious with me. Now I consider what you are saying me. I didn't listen that much before. But now I know about the weight it has for you in your life. And so it would be bad if the other person could not be furious and show the fury, because a great possibility would be given away. How can we deal, to conclude, how can we deal with aggression in a purposeful way? The goal is to solve the central problem of aggression. The central problem of aggression is that it is blind. It is full of inconsideration towards values at large. And so we can apply steps to make the blind aggression, the aggression which does not see what it is doing, which is not personalized, to make it seeing the situation, to imply some respect to the aggression in a threefold way. We can try to make aggression seeing towards the outside, towards the inside, and towards the respect to how it can be lived. Seeing in respect towards the outside. When we are aggressive, to look at the cause, the object of the aggression. At whom is my hate directed? What has hurt me so much? Where is the origin of the threat? Is it really so threatening as I feel it? Because sometimes we have a distorted view. We are oversensitive. And why is it so hurting? We look for the addressee of our aggression, because aggression can be switched over to other persons. If I'm afraid to show my aggression towards my boss, I come home and show it towards my partner. So it can be transferred. It is a quantity of energy, and energies can be transferred. So therefore, it is important to look, to have a close look to the origin of, the cause and the origin of my being hurt, of the danger, of the threat. And it helps us to evaluate the magnitude of the threat. Seeing towards the outside, from where does it come? Who and what is really the enemy, the threat? And then seeing towards the inside, seeing with respect to what is going on with me. What are the values that my aggression wants to protect? What does my hatred protect? The existential ground is reached when it becomes apparent what positive value my aggression wants to defend. There is always a positive value wrapped into aggression. This is the meaning of aggression. This is the purpose. This is why we become aggressive, because we want to protect and to defend something so valuable, our relation to the world, to life and the other, and to other beings, human beings, to ourselves, and to the context in which we are. This makes aggression understandable. This gives aggression a positive aspect. The danger is that aggression, if it is used blindly, can destroy more than help, than it is helpful. And therefore, if we make aggression seeing, we can apply aggression seeing, in a seeing way. Aggression has a value. If it is not understood, then we get feelings of guilt when we feel aggressive, and we reject or repress aggression, and then we lose a big capacity to come to a better life. So, aggression is too valuable to just being acted out. It leads, this seeing towards the inside leads to an evaluation of the potential loss of values. And then the third step is that aggression with respect to how it can be lived should be evaluated. That how can I bring it into this world so that we can come can be used purposefully? How the positive of aggression can be made useful? How it reaches the recipient to whom it belongs? To the source, can I bring it to the source of the evil? To that end, it is important to personally stand for it and perceive the aggression as justified, necessary. Aggression becomes then personalized, humanized, and loses its blind destructiveness. And it can be used in a helpful way, and it can reduce the source of the evil. And therefore, we need aggression, but we should try that we humanize our aggression and bind it into our being a person and and penetrate the aggression with this view, with this seeing, to detoxify the aggression. The detoxification of the aggression is its blindness. And when it is seeing, it is a very helpful power. Thank you for your attention. The question is, how does it happen that when there is a shift of the target of aggression? How is this possible? Neurologically speaking, it means that in aggression, the aggressive centers and the fear, the anxiety centers are loaded, and there is the pain. There's a quantity of neurological impulses which are contained in these centers. And aggression has a tendency to want to be deloaded, to be effective. And so if I feel inhibited to live my aggression, and so we see even when we are aggressive, we are still seeing and say, well, towards my boss, it's too risky. He is stronger. So I can't live it out, and I keep it, and I have it in me, and I go home loaded by this painful experience, full of pain and some anger and some anxiety, and I'm at home, and it needs a spark of behavior, and it explodes, because it is ready to be active. It is like powder, gunpowder, which can explode with a little spark.
Can that explain mass shootings?
And that's explained?
That explains mass shootings as well.
Mass shootings, it is something of this, that people are depressive, that they suffer, and mass shooting is a form of transference of aggression. And this is so terrible. Energy can be transferred. Gasoline is energy, and we can transport it. Or batteries is energy, there's energy, and we can transport it. This is a physical law, and this is the same law is true for neurological energy. And the aim, therefore, in therapy or in working with it is to make it visible, to see, and to make it seeing. And then this transference cannot happen so easily. But the aim is not to eliminate the aggression. Sometimes the aggression goes down when we have a closer look to what happened, because it's not so bad as it looked at the first view. Of course. Exactly, yeah. This is a displacement to other person, who are innocent, who don't even know that I'm so aggressive, who look at me and stare at me. What's going on with you? What happened to you? Yeah. I don't know you that way. This is not you. This is impersonal, you know. Aggression is not me as a person. It's not authentic. It is a load of energy. It's true, yeah. Not only physical harm is aggression, there's also psychological or wordings or talks and even a sight or blick when I look at somebody.
Yeah. Oh, visual.
Visual aggression, yeah.
Right here, yeah.
Sorry?
I'm curious how racism fits into this.
Racism?
Yeah.
Racism is primarily a form of evaluation.
that brings a person to the conviction that one race is better than the other, and that one race is full of failure, and therefore does not have the same value as the other race. And racism, of course, can lead to an aggression, because on this understanding of the difference of races, it doesn't need that much that I react protectively when a person from a lower race or a better race is doing something, or when there are more people around from this race which is not so good, then I feel a threat, a menace. And I feel I do not belong to them. And the exclusion of belonging is the strongest trigger for aggression. And so we have the bridge between an attitude, a conviction, a philosophy, an ideology, I don't know what, to an aggressive psychological behavior. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you suffer from all forms of aggression at the same time, I consider therapy. Yeah. And in such a situation, there can be a mixture of different forms of aggression at the same time, like hate and fury and intolerance and grudge. Yeah, yeah. And in general, in normal people, there are differences between the levels or the reactivity in point of view of aggression. Some people react easily with aggression. They learned it from childhood. There are genetic influences. They, by the way, have been studied in Canada and showed that there are aggressive levels which are combined with the experiences of the first year of life. And there is a higher stress level, and this stress level remains throughout life, and so on. There is higher reachability. But normally, we can come along, and our partners and the society in which we live influence us in our aggression and teach us and punish us if we are too aggressive. And so, and this is the way how we stabilize normally aggression. But there are, of course, people with a higher level or a lower level of a lower threshold of aggression. And for them, it is good to do some psychotherapy, to learn to heighten their threshold and to not to exert control over their affects and impulses and also aggression. And of course, there are personality disorders like borderline personality disorder, which are full of aggression and destructive and hate, full of hate and fury, and they need therapy. They are really destructive and hurt and damage other people. And this, there are about 5 to 6% in the population who need therapy because of their level of aggression. Mm-hmm. That's true. We are a sum of experience, and we are on the genetic base, we are also, we developed our genetic base by the experiences with the outer world. And so we have different levels of aggression, and we have learned how to deal with our life. And when the aggression level is high, and because it was applied often and it was successful, then we develop a pattern of life which makes use of this automatic behavior much more use than is needed. And it should be learned to decrease it. And on the other side, not only learning to decrease it, but also to understand how it came that it was such a high level of aggression.
There is contact.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Viktor Frankl is an example of a person who suffered very much and almost lost his life in several times, not only once, in the concentration camp. You can read about it in Man's Search for Meaning. And at the end, he was not for revenge. He said, we can interrupt this cycle of violence only if we try to forgive and not to blame a generation who is not responsible for it. But we must see the perpetrators. We must see who were the ones who triggered this chain of violence. There are leading personalities, not only in the government, also in the population. And there are many, many more people who followed them, who are not innocent, but not real perpetrators. But, and this made it a mass movement. Therefore, it is important to stabilize the personality of the single individual that we have less followers, mass followers, in the future, but more autonomic personalities who are responsible for themselves. And this means to teach people, to develop people, to help people. And this was his life content afterwards. Thank you.
Good, good. Perhaps one last question. I'm sorry we don't have time for all of them. One last here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We know that an important factor for being wounded and becoming aggressive is the capacity or the capability of the human being to identify and empathize. And when people do a lot of aggressive games or video games, we can observe a higher level of aggression between them because they empathize, they identify with their enemies in the game, and they step out loaded, not always. The investigation about video games are contradictory. Some investigations show that there is more aggression around these, mostly young people, and some show that they have more or less the same level than other young people. It may depend on the type of video game, if there is a chance that they can exert their aggression and bring it to their enemies and have a chance to bring it to their enemies, that they are calm afterwards. And if there are video games in which they cannot come to a real good end for them, they remain loaded and then they are more aggressive. Yeah. But in general, it looks like at the moment, but the investigation is still going on. This is not a secured basis yet. But it looks like that aggressive video games make people more aggressive. But in Spain, of course, when you have the torero, this is also, and in ancient Rome, when in the Colosseum, when they killed animals and killed soldiers and so there was a lot of aggression which was played out on this level. We have no investigation of the ancient Rome, and I'm not aware of any investigation in Spain with the toreros. Mm-hmm. So this would be interesting. Yeah? Thank you for this idea.
Good. Thank you. Well, thank you all here for coming. We thank you, especially you, Alfried, for presenting tonight. And we want to thank also especially St. Paul's Hospital. They make this available for us. They record the videos for us. So we're very deeply grateful to St. Paul's and to Providence Health for their support for us. Thank you all for coming.